Good evening, everyone. It is really, really, really nice to be at the Palestinian National Theatre in Jerusalem, to fill the seats here, but also to be in a place where we can say whatever we like. It is one of those few places that we left and we adore and we admire and we appreciate. It is our house. We say in Arabic, Hakawati Baitna, it's our house. And we go around in circles, but we always come back to Hakawati, and that is, we are grateful for this place. For those people who are asking, this event was supposed to be at the French Institute. We got all the agreements and all the green lights to go ahead with it, and we started indeed publicity until we were surprised that the event cannot be taken care, cannot be happening, cannot be taking place at the French Institute. Our dear neighbor, the neighbor that we have been, and we will continue to work for years to come, hopefully. We're still in the understanding of exactly what is the complications and what is the ins and what's the outs, but we are not also going to allow anyone to censor us or to limit our conversation or to close doors for us. So we have another venue and we are here today. And we will continue. And we continue to find answers and to find exactly what was the French connection regarding this event. But for now, thank you very much for coming, and sorry for the delay a little bit. I'll leave you in the trusted hands of Inès Abdel Razek, the director of the Palestinian Institute for Public Diplomacy. Thank you.
Yeah, I just wanted to add a word on that. I think it's very unfortunate. So my name is Inès Abdel Razek, and I'm Palestinian. I'm also French, and so I think you know, it's unfortunate that I think international presence here, you know, aims at solidarity and the partnership with the Palestinians. I think such censorship, or at least I think worry and fear of the truth, because we're talking about the reality. Is extremely problematic, and I think is eroding the trust that we can have in also international, the international community in their role that they're playing here, that is not neutral. So I hope, and you know, that I think institutions will also review the way that they're approaching these things. We're doing a book launch, so you know, you don't have to agree with everything that's in the book. I think what's important is that we can actually speak about realities and speak about what we need to speak about. So I'm very so honored to be moderating this panel today, this book launch. The book that Mr. Dr. Uri Davis just released, and in the presence of Professor Ilan Pappe, who presented and introduced the book. So without further ado, I'll just present them a bit more in detail, so they don't need presentation, obviously. But we'll spend the next hour here talking about, basically, they will present the book and its findings, and you know, hopefully give you the will to buy it and to buy more books about what we're going to talk about. And then we'll have questions from you, so do prepare and you know, do think about the questions you want to ask, because we really want to have some time for an exchange with you. So, very welcome to Dr. Uri. Ala sahla. So Dr. Uri Davis, in his, it's hard to summarize 8 decades of your life in a summary.
You've got eight decades to do.
Exactly. In just a couple of minutes, Dr. Uri is an anti-Zionist anthropologist of Jewish origin and of European origin, of the Hebrew language speaking group, born in Jerusalem in 1943. He's a citizen of apartheid state of Israel and, as you say, the allegedly democratic monarchy of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. So during your life journey, you've, let's say, left a few marks. One of them, you've been one of the first, you know, in the history of apartheid Israel to have moved yourself from the settler colony, the privileged settler colony of Kfar Shemayahu.
Kfar Shemayahu, it's Herzliya area.
to the colonized Palestinian locality of Deir al-Assad in the 60s. You have been the first in the history of academic Middle East studies in the UK to have co-founded a Palestine studies program, collateral to the University of Exeter in the 80s. You have been the first member of Fateh of Jewish and European origin, and you have actually been appointed to the Revolutionary Council of Fateh. Further to that, I think you have been the first academic and Palestine solidarity activist to have introduced the term apartheid Israel as a cornerstone in Western academic and Palestine solidarity narrative in actually 1987 when you wrote a book about it. And I think today it seems that I think we've done a lot of progress on that, but you're a pioneer when it was almost seemed impossible to talk about. You have published extensively in the field of critical Middle East studies and Palestine studies. So you have written Israel and Apartheid States in 1987, reedited after. And you have also co-wrote a book already about the Jewish National Fund. So it's not, obviously you've been researching this topic for a long time with Walter Lamb. And many, many other books, so I really encourage you to look at his bibliography and to read all of the wonderful work done on ethnic cleansing and the role of the JNF and others. And very honored also to have with us for the discussion Professor Inès Abdel Razek, who's an historian and activist, also doesn't need presentation, but I'll briefly present him. He's the director of the European Center for Palestine Studies at the University of Exeter. He's the author of more than 20 books, among them The Ethnic Cleansing of Palestine, On Palestine with Noam Chomsky, and his most recent books are Our Vision for Liberation with Ramzi Baroud and The Historical Dictionary of Palestine with Joni Mansour. Some of them you can find at the Educational Bookshop, you can find them outside this room. So I encourage you also to obviously read all of these books. So today we're here to present this new book and for them to present the findings, give you a bit of a sense of what's in the book so you can further read it. And the book is about the Jewish National Fund and the Jewish National Fund, KKL, which stands for, and I always forget, it's the Kerem Kayemet Le'Israel, it's the other name of the Jewish National Fund. It's an alternative guidebook to JNF forests and recreational area. So I think what we want to start with is Dr. Uri. This book has a very interesting, I think, so I've read it over the past week. It's a book that you don't have to read linearly. I think one can really take this as a guidebook. Where you can pick different stories, different parts based on your research, based on your field research, and a lot of the countries that you've seen and you've done a lot of research about it. So, can you tell us? We have 10 minutes for you to present the content of the book and the findings as you would.
Thank you. Do I have sound?
Yeah, you're okay.
But I'll take a minute out of the 5 minutes or 10 minutes I have for apologies and corrections. First of all, I'm not the first person of Jewish origin who was elected to the Palestine Revolutionary Council. There was a person who is now deceased and deserves absolute applause and mention. His name is Ilan Pappe. He was the first to join Fatah and to join the Fatah Revolutionary Council. The difference, however, is significant because, as you may have noticed, I introduced myself as of Jewish origin and of European origin. Ilan actually entered Fatah as of Jewish origin but also Arab origin, which meant a smoother entry. That's one. The other is that I want to thank a good friend Adel manna for the sweets he organized, very delicious and expensive sweets he organized as a gift for my birthday. But it also meant that I was delayed entering the hall, so I apologize. And finally, you may or may not have noticed that my beard, my moustache, is actually all going overlapping my mouth right until my lower lip. The reason being is that I'm undergoing dental surgery and implants of teeth. And if I don't actually cover my mouth, I'll frighten people looking at me rather than pleasing people looking at me. So again, an apology. But finally, I want to know is the Freedom Fighter Jacob Order in the audience? So, part of my time I want to devote to Jacob Order and give him an opportunity to speak from the panel. And the reason is rather obvious. We are convening in Jerusalem. And specifically in Jerusalem, we are convening next to the Hebrew University in Jerusalem. And next to the Hebrew University in Jerusalem, there is a compound inhabited by the Akel family. And the Akel family has successfully, over the decades, resisted attempts at evacuation and confiscation of their property. And it seems at the time that they have finally won some respite when a recent confiscation order was issued and stuck on the boundaries of their compound. So their case, they are refugees from Lifta, and they built their home on Lifta property that happened to be next to the Hebrew University student compound, student resident compound. And I thought the fact that we convene in Jerusalem under Israeli occupation, and specifically under the danger of losing much of the properties in Jerusalem, that I give part of my panel to Jacob Order, who is also a very close personal friend together with the Akel family. And having said that much, I will concentrate only on one issue relevant to this book. For quite some time, I had at the back of my mind a question which I could not fully answer. How was it possible for a state that is at core an apartheid state, completely similar to apartheid South Africa, at least as I understand apartheid, and I make a distinction between racism and apartheid. Racism is an ugly phenomenon that prevails in almost, if not all, societies. But apartheid is something special characterizing its regime. It's racism regulated and imposed in law. In law. Racism, I lead to the field of ugliness that is not regulated in law, but by other standards like tradition or tribalism or whatever, specifically in law. In former South Africa, apartheid, just under 90% of the territory of the state was reserved in law for whites only. And some of you, many of you, all of you would be aware that I'm not talking on pre-67 or 1948 Israel, just over 90% of the territory is reserved in law for Jews only. Now, how was it possible for a state which at core is an apartheid state, and the question of territory is the question of every settler colonial invasion, whether in Africa or in the Middle East, how was it possible for this state to project itself over decades as the only democracy in the Middle East? And progressively, I approached an answer, maybe a partial answer, maybe a comprehensive answer, and came to appreciate the importance of the cover-up, the veil. In apartheid South Africa, apartheid was not really veiled. The sovereign did not bother to veil apartheid, and there's a term called petty apartheid in the years of apartheid South Africa. Right upon landing at the airport, one hit upon lines for whites and lines for non-whites, buses, transport for whites and non-whites, toilets for whites and non-whites. the Israeli sovereign, the political Zionist Israeli sovereign, was a bit more careful and probably more shrewd. They realized that one does not need petty apartheid in order to secure just over 90% of the territory for Jews only. There is no petty apartheid then regulated in law, or very little petty apartheid regulated in law in Israel. No lines at the Lidan airport for Jews and lights for non-Jews. No, in law I'm speaking, buses for Jews and buses for non-Jews, toilets for non-toilets. You enter Israel and you don't immediately get apartheid hitting your face. And then, of course, we come to the Jewish National Fund, which is registered as a charity in many member states of the United Nations, tax-exempt charity, projecting itself as an environmental organization, planting trees. And in the forests of the Jewish National Fund, one will recognize recreational areas developed by the Jewish National Fund. The interesting thing is that in these recreational areas, if you visit them on public holidays or weekends, you'd find Arab families next to Jewish families, barbecuing happily next to each other, and children frolicking on the swings, very happy together. There is no physical barrier. If, for instance, any of the students or a student of any Canadian university would come with a group to Canada Park, and the leadership of that group would be taken by a Jewish National Fund leader. And let's assume that one of the students was courageous enough to raise his finger modestly, timidly, like this, and said, I read a paper by a certain Dr. Davis claiming that the JNF is an apartheid organization complicit with ethnic cleansing and with crimes against humanity. They would be probably taken in the first instance to the recreational area. And the leader, if he remained cool and quite knowledgeable or properly trained, would say, what? Apartheid? How come apartheid? This is an Arab family, this is a Jewish family, here are the children frolicking on the winds. Where is the barrier? There is no barrier. Where is physical separation? There is no physical separation. But I doubt that the leader of that particular group would take the group further into the forest and point, this is the desecrated graveyard of Abbas. These are the ruins of Yanu. These are the desecrated graveyard of Beit Nuba. No. It is this veil, this cover, that allows the Jewish National Fund project itself as a tax-exempt organization, collect contributions to tax-exempt, namely they take the money from the common wealth, from taxes that people pay in Canada and elsewhere, and by this quote-unquote charitable mechanism, actually, every tax-paying citizen in Canada or in any other country where the JNF is active and has a charity registration, renders every citizen complicit with the crime against humanity of the ethnic cleansing of Palestine. The JNF did not actually ethnically cleanse Iwas or Yavin or Beit Nuba. It's the Israeli army who did it. Nor did the JNF actively expel the people of Marha or Birim or Ikrit, the Israeli army did. But by planting these forests and by developing these recreational areas, they are complicit with the crime against humanity of the ethnic cleansing of Palestine. And before I end, I also want, lest I forget, say you mentioned, Ines, that I was the one to first introduce the term apartheid into academic and Palestine solidarity narrative. And that is correct. But one has to credit my friend and colleague Ilan Pappe for first introducing the term ethnic cleansing. So between a pioneer of ethnic cleansing narrative and a pioneer of anti-apartheid narrative, it is my fervent wish that step by step through gatherings of this kind and through mobilization that takes place wonderfully well with the BDS international movement of boycotting apartheid Israel, we actually witness within our lifetime something which is my cherished hope. My cherished hope is that if I'm allowed to celebrate my 90th birthday, I will at least witness the Jewish National Fund charitable status crossed out, nullified in anywhere of the member states where it is, until today, recognized as a charity.
Thank you. Before I pass to Professor Ilan, I have two very short sort of follow-up questions for you. I think what's fascinating in the book, and again, this is a topic very close to my heart because my grandparents were ethnically cleansed from Azib in the north, and now it's a park, run by the Israeli Environment Authority. And I think part of what you explain very well, which I think is confusing to me and to many people, is the at the core of it is how the state of Israel is managing the land. And so first the Zionist movement, and then what became the state of Israel, how they have, as you said, avoided petty apartheid, but I think where the management of the land and the sophisticated rules in place that you explained there have been articulated so that they would put this veil and so led it to different institutions. So, just very briefly, because I think what's fascinating is the articulation between the JNF, which is not directly a state of Israel institution, but it has basically been given some power by laws passed by the Knesset. So there is the articulation that was made between the land authority, the JNF, as part of the World Zionist Organization, and the Jewish, also the Jewish Agency for the Land of Israel. That, I think, is so fascinating because that's at the core of how the JNF operates hand in hand with the state.
The JNF is only one of six executive arms of the World Zionist Organization. And the World Zionist Organization is not a conspiracy and not a curse. It's an international institution, just as PepsiCo and Coca-Cola is an international body, and it has branches in many member states of the United Nations Organization, and it has congresses every number of years, usually every 4 or 5 years, and branches, and there are elections, etc., 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 and it has a constitution, and it has a vision, and so forth and so on. It's a legal person. So you have the World Zionist Organization as a legal person. Until 1948, it was technically voluntary. In 1948, it became, beginning 1948, a process of making, regulating its status in the state of Israel took place, and in the early 50s, it became an organization recognized by the Knesset, by Israeli legislation, as a legal body. And was endowed with certain functions. The JNF is one of its functions, the Jewish Agency is another one of functions, the fundraising body called the Foundation Fund, and so forth. There are six. Now what is happening in Israel is actually brilliant from a Zionist point of view, and awful from a Palestinian point of view. The state, this arm represents the sovereignty of the state of Israel. And this arm represents the body of the World Zionist Organization. The state rolled back its, in certain areas, its sovereignty, and vested the responsibility with the World Zionist Organization. Now, if we do a simulation which Ilan would hate, and he would be a representative of the Israeli embassy, and I would be a representative of the Palestine Solidarity, we could do it exactly the other way around. If Ilan stood here in front of us and said, the state of Israel does not discriminate on an ethnic or a tribal basis, does not discriminate between Jew and non-Jew, technically, there is substance to the claim, but unless Ilan says it actually mandated, authorized, covenanted the apartheid discrimination to a body called the Jewish National Fund or the World Zionist Organization, that is usually not advertised. So the state rolled back its sovereignty, for instance, in the area of immigration to Israel, and vested the function with the Jewish agency, and the Jewish agency is for Jews only. The state rolled its sovereignty in the area of afforestation and vested the function to the Jewish National Fund. The state rolled its sovereignty in this or any other area and vested Jewish National Fund. I'll give you an example and give me an extra 2 minutes. I actually acted as a, well, it's a terrible word, but that's the legal word, as an agent. Shaliach. Shaliach is a much nicer word. Shaliach means an emissary. It's a positive connotation. Agent is a, can have a negative connotation, but in the law it means agency, like the Peugeot agency or newspaper agency, etc., etc. I went as an agent, formerly as an agent, on behalf of an Arab family who were interested to build their home in an old Jewish settlement. I won't go into the detail. The family was immediately rejected, Mohammed family. Very immediately rejected, this is only for Jews, developed by the Jewish agency. But I came as an agent, middle-class elderly gentleman, looking academic and so forth. I was immediately signed on the papers, initial papers. And then there was an interview, and I was asked to give a paragraph or two of my curriculum vitae in my handwriting before the interview committee, which I did. I saw no reason why to give them anything other than my formal qualifications, which I did, age, etc., etc. I'm interested to build the house. If they ask me how I voted the election, it's none of their business. They didn't even bother to ask me what I was about to do in the house. They assumed X, Y, Z, because they're a bunch of racists. I passed the interview. After the interview, I was sent to the Jewish agency to sign a contract. So I passed the interview, I had the membership documents, I'm a member of the Cooperative Society of Katsir. I was then inside a new paper that with a Jewish agency, only for Jews, Katsir is only for Jews, and then I was sent to the government body called Minhal Mekarke Israel, the Israel Lands Administration, and signed a lease of 49 years with the Minhal Mekarke Israel. The document I signed with the Israel Land Administration has no discrimination and not an iota of discrimination between Jew and non-Jew. But they won't sign a contract with you unless you brought to them the previous two documents. That's how it works. The importance of veiling a core apartheid, I came to realize, is a critical element, and it's actually not just a public relation necessity for Israeli apartheid, it's an existential necessity. Not for the state of Israel as a member state in the UN, but for the maintenance and existence of the apartheid regime in the state of Israel. And this book was actually, the subtitle suggests, an alternative guidebook. And this book, again, in my private ambitions and the audience to which it is addressed, is it can actually be a testimony before court, because it's direct eyewitness reported. And if it is taken to any given court and submitted as evidence against the JNF, I would have my full reward. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And again, yes, the book is full of these, the stories related in the book about the family you talk about and what you did and other families. And I think you list as well, that it's very rich in information in terms of listing, obviously not only the villages that were ethnically cleansed, but also all the projects of the GNF by country. And because I think it's very well divided in terms of GNF branches in Canada and Australia and Spain all have actually proud themselves in having developed these forests, and they continue to promote them. And it reminds me that Kamala Harris, the U.S. Vice President, was just at the event of celebrating 75th year of what they call the Israeli independence, and she boasted about, you know, donating to the JNF little blue box when she was a kid, and still, again, priding herself into supporting such institutions. So I turn now to Professor Ilan. Thank you so much. I guess you introduced the book, so I'll let you introduce the book the way you want and complement what Dr. Uri has.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me. It's a great opportunity to say thank you to Uri for a wonderful and very industrious and very comprehensive work. I was fortunate enough to read the manuscript at an early stage and to write a foreword to the book. And it is really a unique testimony for the way the Jewish National Fund, has operated in the past, and is still, in many ways, operating in the present, and contributing to the ongoing dispossession of the Palestinians from their villages and fields, and as the Palestinians call it, contribute to the ongoing Nakba and Mustamera. First of all, I want to say to Uri that, to your credit, even before you, to your credit, you can't hear me from here. Okay, I'll talk even louder. To your credit, even before you went to the dentist, a lot of Israelis were very fearful when they saw it. So you should be proud of that. Secondly, I would like to, as you say, kind of to contextualize it a bit wider, maybe even make a bit of a discussion between us so that we agree on most of the things for sure, but I would like to maybe provide complementary angle to this. I really would have wished that the problem for the exceptional immunity that Israel enjoys in the world is because it succeeds to deceive the world. I really wish this would be true. Then I would say to myself, yes, there's so many of us who are able to, you know, to expose the truth. And we have been doing it. Adel Manai is here, Uri is here, I'm here, so many of us. And we are respected outside of Israel. And even before we did our work, it was possible to expose Israel for what it is. And yet, it did not change the international community perception of Israel. And I think this is very interesting also in the context of the Jewish National Fund, and in fact all the pre-1948 organizations which were part of the World Zionist Organization. Zionism was not only a settler colonial project, namely it was not just interested in colonizing people, it was interested in displacing people and replacing them, in taking out the indigenous people and indigenize the immigrants as if they are the native people of the land. It also was a project at the time when decolonization already started. It began its massive ethnic cleansing in 1948, in a year in which the West decided that there is a moral obligation to protect people's human rights and civil rights in the famous Human Rights Declaration that came in 1948. And in fact, if you look at the Palestinian newspapers from 1948 and even before that, you can see that throughout the mandate, the position of the Palestinians in general, those who articulated their thoughts in writing, those who met an endless number of inquiry commissions who came to Palestine during the mandatory period. The basic position was the West has replaced the Ottoman Empire with true basic principles which we, the Palestinians, accept. One principle is democracy. The majority of people define the nature of the country that used to be part of the Ottoman Empire and its future. Yes, we as Palestinians are willing to accept the democratic principle in order to define Palestine. The second principle was the right for self-determination, which was already cherished by President Wilson in the end of the First World War, and definitely was repeated by the United Nations in 1945. This created a certain problem, not only for the Zionist movement, but also for those who supported the Zionist movement for religious reasons, which was the whole evangelical Christian church, and for Islamophobic reasons, which was very much part of the British decision to allow a Jewish state instead of a Palestinian state. But there was an issue there. There was an issue of justifying the colonization of Palestine, and in an age of decolonization, and in the aftermath of the Second World War, when everybody wanted to talk about democracy, human rights, and civil rights. What the Zionist movement did, it used all the colonialist instrument that it had before 1948, including the Jewish National Fund, to become part of a network of advocacy and propaganda that would try to say, yes, this is not a place that was not decolonized, but it is still the same place that you as Christians and as Jews supported, either for religious reasons, strategic reasons, or ideological reasons. So I think it's very important to contextualize the Jewish National Fund both before 1948 and after 1948 in the huge project of advocacy that Zionism has always invested in, and really nowadays Israel even has a special ministry of strategic affairs that invests in this, in order to try and square the circle. How can it be that on the basis of the same principles that the West has brought to the Middle East at the end of the First World War, the project of displacement and replacement has been internationally recognized? So that's the first point I think is important about the Jewish National Fund. The other thing, which I think is really, and this comes out in the book in a very, very clear way, it always reminds me of the question that people ask, why do dictators want referendums? I mean, they can force everyone to admit, to accept them as rulers. And yet they would go, you know, they would go to elections. They would like to get 99.5 of the electorate. It makes them feel legitimate. The amount, and I think that's what I learned from this book, the amount of legal discourse, the amount of legal effort, the amount of legislation that Israel invests since 1948, and the Zionist movement invested before 1948, in a project of pillage, in a project of robbery, in a project of dispossession, in a project of ethnic cleansing, is mind-boggling. It's mind-boggling. And I think, Uri, you're absolutely right. It's a smokescreen. It really is a sense that if you say, you know, we have a legal system and it weighs the legal consideration, it's a matter of property, the rights of property, and we can see it in Sheikh Jarrah, how they're using it in order to evict Palestinian families, but they would never, of course, apply it to West Jerusalem. It's very clear that this is a manipulative tool to probably, first of all, domestically, for domestic consumption, to feel, I'm not a robber. I'm not involved in a pillage. Even before you go outside, in order to say to the world, you know, it's all legal. It's all justified. We have lawyers. We have prosecutors, we have a legal system. We are not taking people's property with the power of the gun. It is part of the process of legislation. Legitimizing Zionism and legalizing Zionism are twin projects that create a smokescreen, but I really think it less directed to the world as much as it is directed internally. For the Israeli Jews, this is the one of the, and you're all familiar with this, I'm sure, the righteousness of Israeli Jews, the sense of moral superiority, the only moral army in the world, an enlightenment occupation, and so on. This is something that I think is very important, and I think what the book does is really to show us that despite the very detail of the attention to legal details in every act of robbery that Uri reports in the book, it is quite bewildering that it is an act of robbery. It is an act of pillage. It is an act of ethnic cleansing, and yet it is covered with all these details. And if you talk to any one of the Palestinians who was involved, especially in the negotiation in Camp David in the summer of 2000, but even before that, in the negotiations around Oslo, the amount of legal, the number of legal advisors that the Israeli delegation brought with them, is incredible. The mountains of legal papers that Israel prepared for the Camp David summit in 2000, in order to say to the Palestinians, we now have the power actually to turn Oslo into the final kind of settlement that we are interested in, shows you this connection that I think the book brings to the fore. And the last thing I want to say in this context, and with this I will finish, the Jewish National Fund did play one particular role during the ethnic cleansing of 1948, which I think very few other agencies played. And you're right, they were not the ones who occupied and displaced people, but they were essential for the member side of the Palestinian countryside. Their main objective was to plant recreational forests on the ruins of Palestinian villages, or to build settlements in order to erase the memory of what was there before. And this is why they brought European pine trees, to make sure that they don't only erase the Palestinian presence, they try to de-Arabize the landscape, to turn it into a European landscape. And this act of memricide is part of the crime against humanity that happened in 1948. And to think that the architect of this memricide and the continuum of this memricide until today are hailed around the world as presenting the ecological projects of Israel, the green lungs of Israel, is really mind-boggling, as I said. But the fact that there is the Hakawati Theater, the fact that not far away from here, Orient House is still standing, and that the Muna brothers have their educational bookshop, and you are here, means that the memory side has not succeeded, and will not succeed, and hopefully, with the fusion of academic work with activism, which Uri was such a great example of, would enable us to continue the fight against the dispossession in the present and in the future, and we will all contribute to the liberation of Palestine. Thank you.
By the Educational Bookshop, that I would want to devote some time to Jakob Bode.
Yes, we'll invite him to the stage.
So I wonder if Jakob Bode is
in the audience. Yeah, absolutely. And
we need,
and then we'll exchange with the room.
We need another chair.
I can bring my chair.
Jakob Bode, from refugee from Lifta village, kid from my village, Nakba, Palestine, of 1948. Lifta, one village of 770 village occupied by Israel in 1947, and one of 531 village destroyed. Lifta is the western gate of Jerusalem. In Lifta there were 3,000 Liftawis living in more than 550 houses. All of them kicked out of their village and everywhere in this world. I want to talk about the Nakba, 1948, but as our professor said, the Nakba Mustamira is going on. Also, I want to talk about the plan to change Lifta for Israeli colony, to build in it to 159 luxury villas and a mall and a hotel and other things. Nor I want to talk about the new plan project to build three towers, each of them 40 and more floors in the upper part of Lifta. Lifta, not enough that the Knesset built on Lifta, the Hebrew University, the Mabani, the government buildings, and also bus station, train station, all these things in Lifta land. That wasn't enough for the Israeli Land Department, which is the main thief for the Palestinian property in Palestine. So we have a new plan. Plan in East Jerusalem, in Ard Samar, that they named it Har Tzufim, to build a tower, 30 floors, contain more than 500 house units on our land, Lifta land. Before that, the Hebrew University built on our land, 1920s, and also the British Makbara, graveyard, cemetery on our land, and also some of Hadassah Hospital on our land. Also, annually, after 1980s, they built in our land Hyatt Regency Hotel, sporting area for the university, and also the government's buildings in Sheikh Jarrah, also the police, district center on our land. They took the building which built to be a hospital, and changed it for a police center. But now we have a new plan to build in where the Hyatt Regency goes to north on your right hand. There is a student building, Adelson, and after there are about 29 donors. They want to build a tower more than 30 floors. This means to change the demography. Always they are talking about demography, bombs. Okay. But it's our land. This is our house. They planning in the municipality or in Israeli land department as if the land empty. No one. There is no one. So they close their rooms and make the plan to build. Because the main idea is ethnic cleansing for the Palestinians from their home, from their land. I think yani more than 65 years since the Nakba. 75 years since the Nakba. But still we are here. And we will remain here. Many occupied Palestine. Roman, Persian, many. And Israel. They come. And Israel also will not remain on our chest. This is our right. Our right in our land, in our home. The Hebrew University shared in the game. 1973, they sent letters for 11 families, which their number that time was about 50, to leave their homes so as to destroy their homes to build more gardens, more parking, and more housing also. Which university? You imagine that university teach housing rights, democracy, the right to live, the right to live, but not to kick out people from their homes and destroy their homes and to build more gardens or more parking for their cars. These days, also the university, as if they sold the land or the Adelson building for a new investment for Israeli or for the Israeli land department. So they want to destroy this building and to kick the people out. Muhammad Akil, he has a small boy. His family had houses in Lifta, in the lower part, also in where the Knesset built their land there. Akil, Khalaf, Qasim, these Liftawis family, that the Knesset and the foreign minister also built on their land. Also, they have three houses in West Jerusalem, in Kalubia, and in Bukharia, also behind the police school here in Sheikh Jarrah. And now they want to destroy his home, to kick him from his home, to build also a new buildings for the Israeli land department. And his grandmother, his grand-nan, Aisha, she was a hero. She used to sleep not in her home, in front of her home, to form the bulldozers to come and destroy her home. She died. She died. From the university plan, Also, Hajj Ali Shalaf, the same. He had his land also where the parliament, Knesset, I don't know which democracy built on the other's land or the other's. Yes. The High Court, yani, took the decision. Here are the three authorities. Yani, the three authorities in one direction to strengthen the occupation and to go on more and more, to kick also the Palestinians out from their own. I say, from this place, we will not go. As we used to say in Arabic, من هذا المراح ما في ولا رواح. شكراً.
So, we want to open the floor. And I want to conclude actually with my, because I'm not an academic but an activist hat, and I think again this book is a great tool. The legal sophistication, I think, that we all spoke about, not only to veil but to conduct the ethnic cleansing and the dispossession, has created such absurd status like the one of Ustaz Yaqub of being present absentees. I mean, you know, this is the type of thing that's also discussed in the book, and this is the type of status of legal things that are, you know, that have been put in place to continue, I think, justifying the settler colonialism. And so this book gives, I think, a lot of tools to question the GNF charity status abroad. Lots of, I think, great tools for us to mobilize campaigns and continue campaigns to, I think, expose in a very contemporary way, because I think the word that I haven't seen in the book and we haven't talked about is greenwashing. And I think we're in an era where we're fighting climate change, where the ecological question is so present. And so, of course, planting trees looks like a wonderful and harmless activity. However, I think people are more and more conscious of what greenwashing is, and I think the GNF is at the core of, you know, the state of Israel's greenwashing propaganda. So I'm sure you have lots of questions, so we'll take a few questions, maybe three questions that then they can answer. Please. Ahmad, you... A short, please, short questions, not long comments, please, because we don't have too much time and we want to have, you know, opportunity for many people to be able to ask questions. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. I want to thank Ilan Pappe and Uri Davis for the great work you've been doing over the years. Yeah. But my question is, after all the revelations you have done about Ben Gruen, the Polish migrant who came to this land, you know, who migrated to Palestine, as being the mastermind behind all the evictions, the ethnic cleansing, the plan done at March 1948 in your book. Now my question, can we bring a case against Ben Gruen, Ben Gurion, posthumously in Palestinian courts to say he's a criminal, he's the one who ordered eviction, who ordered ethnic cleansing? And the second issue, would you be willing to be witnesses in such a court? In a Palestinian court.
I thank you both for your really wonderful, sharp presentation. Uri, there's something you said that I found, really interesting, and I just wanted to see if you could clarify. You referred to the State of Israel rolling back its sovereignty to the World Zionist Organization and its branch, the Jewish National Fund.
In law.
In law. Well, that's my point. So the basis is Israeli legislation that delegates, that's why I'm asking, it delegates certain functions and responsibilities, okay, to be performed by WISO and the JNF?
Yeah. There is a covenant between the government of the State of Israel,
yes,
the Jewish National Fund, signed in 1961.
Before that, no. Because this for me, this can have important consequences in terms of the things I work with.
Before that, there were quite a few years of negotiations. And there is no human endeavor that is not pickled and with contradictions, and that also applies to negative projects as much as it applies to positive projects. And the contradictions in the covenant, articulated in the covenant, were actually quite visible to the people who drafted the texts. There is a famous quote in Knesset debates by then Minister Zerach Verhaftik, who pointed out to the Knesset that what they were trying to do with this covenant was to do something quite impossible, to give a legal code to something that is not legal. They were aware of the contradictions. So the process began in the early 50s and matured by 1961. But then it's interesting to see how these contradictions are being negotiated today. The JNF controls about, I'm not aware of the most recent statistics, let's say, plus minus 15% of the territory registered in the land registry in the Tavo in the name of the JNF. I'm talking about 48 Palestine, and plus minus 75% on the name of the state. Now, the properties that the JNF purchased in the early years of the Zionist invasion turned out to be very commercially attractive properties, and the land prices in these parts of the country became astronomically high. I'll give an example of my immediate environment of childhood, Kfar Shmoria. I was born in Jerusalem, but my childhood was in Kfar Shmoria in my adolescence, lands of Haram Sayyidina Ali, the mosque is still there. And I still believe me, people, I still don't understand how we young secondary and elementary school children used to walk from Kfar Shmoria to the Sayyidina Ali beach, see the mosque over there, see the ruins of the destroyed village of Haram Sayyidina Ali, and were not aware or did not recognize that if a mosque is there, then a community is there, and where did the community go? And there are cemeteries around the mosque. The formal and informal indoctrination that we received in school and out of school blinkered our sons just like that. But in Kfar Shmoria, my family purchased a 10-dunam plot, for £1,000. The price of a dunam now is many hundreds of thousands of US dollars. Now, there is an agreement between the state and the Jewish National Fund. If any of the state projects involved urban localities, and these urban localities include also JNF properties, and in urban localities there is no selection committee. In urban localities, Tel Aviv or Haifa or Beersheba, etc., the Palestinian families find difficulties in purchasing flats or properties, but not because it is legally impossible, but because of popular racism or fascism. So there is a piece of land which the state needs in order to complete its plans for urban development. So they developed an exchange program. Commercially classified. The piece of land in let's say the Herzliya area is now worth so many billions of dollars. Well, give us a compensation, land in the Negev, southern Palestine. Land in the Negev, of course, a dunam costs what? Pittance. So you don't get a dunam for dunam, you get 100 dunams of state property, now registered under the name of the JNF, in return for one or two dunams of urban JNF property. So the ratio between state and JNF registered properties is actually quite fluid, but that's the way it now works. The JNF constitutionally is not allowed to sell its properties. So they went around the limitation by developing a daughter company called Himnuta. Himnuta is allowed to exchange and sell properties, but Himnuta is totally owned by the JNF, and much of the criminal work these days in the West Bank and in Jerusalem is actually not done by in the name of JNF, but in the name of Himnuta. Not everybody knows that Himnuta is a JNF arm. So the legalities are very much there, and the contradictions so far have been negotiated to a degree. But I have a but. Ilan said, well, they succeeded a good deal, but they did not succeed completely. Hakawati is there, Palestinian doctors, Abdel Manani, and his family here, etc., etc. And I fully endorse the comment. They didn't succeed in causing a lot of damage. They did succeed in memociding Palestinian territory, but not completely. And believe me, in terms of Zionist conception, a partial victory is considered a failure. They know they failed. They know they have no future in Palestine. The only measure they know is violence, and if a certain measure of violence doesn't do the job, then you add violence to it, and then you add violence to it, and it ends up as a boomerang against you. I'm basically optimistic that Palestine is liberated.
Yeah, the Palestinian court. Just before that, I want to say, you know, the greenwashing remark. The Israeli Hasbara propaganda is one big launderette. They don't just do greenwashing, they do pink washing, they do eco washing, they do high tech washing. But I think it's an important moment because the legalization we talked about, we have a proof that really what worries them is domestically and not externally. The hundreds of thousands of Israelis demonstrate now. They are demonstrating against the government who really doesn't care about legality, that doesn't care about legitimacy. And they are worried, without that shield, how would they face themselves and the world without that structure? So I think this is a very important moment in history in this respect. The court, I don't remember who asked about the court. You asked about the court. You don't have to repeat. I'm old, but I remember your question. It was only, if it was half an hour ago, you would have to repeat it, but I didn't remember it.
Respect you a lot.
Yeah, no, thank you very much. Thank you very much. And thank you for your kind comments, first of all, that's what I wanted to say. Secondly, you know, there has been an international effort called the Russell Tribunal to bring Israel to justice as the official international legal organization refused to do it. And I think also in the case, if there would be such a Palestinian court, of course, the idea I think would be not so much the ability, anyway, most of them are dead, to bring to justice, but I think you want to bring, and rightly so, to justice the event itself, the crime itself, rather than the criminals. I mean, the criminals are dead. Most of these criminals are dead. There are enough contemporary criminals that should be brought. to justice. But definitely, I think to examine properly ethnic cleansing, apartheid, in legal, international legal terms, by a Palestinian court is one of many blessed initiatives, and I'm sure Uri and I more than willing to
I'm testify. Waiting to be invited.
to testify in such a thing. But I do think we have an interesting model with this event in South Africa. You know, the Truce and Reconciliation committees, the whole idea of restitutive justice, where you don't just want the justice, you also want to build on it for a better future and reconciliation in the future. Definitely something to invest in it. I fully agree, and count me in.
Thank you.
Okay, before concluding, I think we can take two other last questions. Two, three, if they're very short.
Hello, Habab Husni, I'm Huda Imam, and I come from Baqa, West Jerusalem. And thank you very much, Ines. Uri, my former colleague from Al-Quds University. Ilan, thank you again for your refreshing, uplifting words, always. In 1998, Netanyahu was in government, and he started selling Palestinian houses in West Jerusalem. How did this happen? Because my father's house was one of the first houses actually sold, like signs, Arab luxury houses for sale. We can still find them when we go to the German colony and Baqa, Talbiyeh, and so on. So how did this happen? I mean, is it like, again, legitimate robbery between KKL and the Israeli government? Thank you.
And then now the houses are sold, so she's asking about the process for that. Like, who basically now owns technically, like, how did this process happen? 1998?
You said? Yeah.
There's 48, obviously, because it was her family's house. And then in 1998, can you repeat about that just to clarify the question?
And when Netanyahu came into governance, he started privatizing water, telecom, etc. And like all government reforms in this cycle of time. And Netanyahu was in governance, and he actually privatized the properties, at least I know about it in West Jerusalem. The properties already confiscated in 1948.
Oh, I see.
Many of them were sold to private real estate agents.
Huda was actually Ariel Sharon. He was not the prime minister then, but he was the minister of infrastructure. Their infrastructure. And they privatized part of the land that belonged to the late Blenders of it. And the privatization, in a way, froze. For the defroze, for the public, or provided the public the ability to buy privately land that would belong to the Israeli Land Authority, and that included what they used to call absentee property. So that was the process was actually to say it's not anymore just JNF or Inuta. Of the Israeli Land Authority is now a free market, everybody can buy. But you know what happened later, and not in West Jerusalem, but when some of that land became available, at least allegedly to everyone, we come back to Uri's tale about Harish, and we saw it in Afula, when Palestinians bought such land, the municipality encouraged the local people not to allow the people who legally bought the land to live there. So it's a process of privatization. Yes, I think it's again, it's legalization and privatization, but an ethnic and racist one. And there, so as Uri says, the language is supposedly neutral, universal, the language of the law, but the practice is always guided by the racist apartheid principles.
I want to add that what I regard as the basic legal documents for Palestinian properties are the Ottoman and British Mandate documents. And these records are available in the UN, in Istanbul, and some of them at least are also available with the government of the Palestinian Authority. Now, on the basis of that document, I believe, and I need legal advice. I'm not a jurist, I'm an anthropologist, but I believe legal advice can be made available in order to submit a petition before an international court, arguing that anything subsequent to this registration, like the custodian of absentee property, like the absentee's property law, like the privatization, is actually illegal. But it's a very long and costly process. And also, I must admit, a dangerous process. Because, for instance, there are families who have properties in Talbiya or in Katamon or in Baha, who have got double papers to support their rights in these properties. For instance, my colleague at the Fatah Revolution Council of Safia at the time suggested mass protests and mass demonstrations moving from East Jerusalem to West Jerusalem, and having families making a sit-in, an indefinite sit-in, at the doorstep of their properties. It's a great idea. It's a great idea, it's an idea that I support. But it's extremely dangerous, because then you get the criminals of the government coming not just only with the wooden clubs, but with their metal clubs, and breaking people's bones or killing them. So you need to have some measure of protection and security to people doing this way. The Palestinian Authority has no access to East Jerusalem.
We'll take that
separate platform. for instance, mobilizing Palestinian citizens of Israel who have access to all parts of Jerusalem to give protection, not armed protection, but give physical protection, surrounding these families and protecting them against the attacks of the government hooligans is no solution. That you'll get Palestinian citizens having their bones broken or actually killed in an attempt to protect Palestinian citizens who are ethnically cleansed from Talbiya, Baqa, or Katamon. So certain avenues of direct actions which are available in Berkeley, California, or in Boston, Massachusetts, are not available to us. And for me, it's particularly painful because I'm actually here since, as a young man, I was hugely impressed by white students in the Ivy League universities of the United States of America actually physically moving their bodies to the southern states and in solidarity, soldier to soldier, marching together with the black people of black citizens of America in defense of their rights to education, equal education, access to education, and the ballot box. Then, of course, people were hit by police wooden clubs and by water jets, but not always or not necessarily in lethal capacity. what is possible there is not possible today, I'm afraid, these days. Still, with a little bit of imagination and through platform of international law, these obstacles can be overcome with some a creative think tank. It would not go amiss. Thank you.
If I might just add something to be careful with all this thing, because I remember in 1998, the right wing to the Likud government was very angry about this plan to privatize the land. They called it an anti-Zionist, anti-Jewish and anti-Zionist project. So namely, taking your land was called by the right wing in Israel anti-Zionist. Now, of course, they didn't do it because they wanted you to stay there. It just shows you how they are themselves confused by not recognizing the difference of the legal language of the government that can be neutral, open to everyone, and how it is practiced in the field. So, in many ways, this is very interesting that this whole privatization, like the building of exclusively Jewish development towns in the north, sometimes is not working for them because people take seriously the idea that this is a universal idea. But of course, Sharon, when he initiated the privatization program in 1998, did not mean that Palestinians would be able. In fact, he had to answer in the Knesset, Netanyahu had to answer in the Knesset. And I just read, while we were talking, I read the speech of the guy who is now the foreign minister of Israel, Eli Cohen. Eli Cohen said to him, what you are doing would allow Palestinians, he meant Israeli Arabs, Israeli citizens, he would allow Palestinians to buy land in Israel. I mean, this is the foreign minister of Israel today. That's what how he was talking. But this is exactly, I think, again, coming back to Uri's book. I mean, this is where we need to explain, even to Israelis sometimes, that the language of the law in Israel counts for nothing when it comes to the apartheid system. It counts for a lot of things, but not for the settler colonial project's main objective of eliminating the native and displacing it. There, neither the Supreme Court of Israel, not the legal question, can be barriers for a project that still belongs to the previous century in terms of its determination of to dispossess a country and take it over from its indigenous people. This has not changed. And you know, there's nothing exceptional here. There's another settler colonial project which did the same. This is Britain in the north of Ireland. In the north of Ireland, still in the 1960s, in order to make sure that Catholics would not influence the democratic elections in the north of Ireland, Britain passed a law that only house owners can vote. Only house owners can vote. This only changed very recently. Only house owners can vote. But why did they do that? Because they knew that most of the Catholics were poor and did not own houses. And most of the Protestants owned houses. So this is not, Israel has not invented the wheel here, but it's most settler colonial projects were exposed long time ago for this kind of manipulation. Uri's book really is an important contribution to exposing the last active settler colonial project on the earth.
Okay, we'll take take final round of three questions that we will answer then all at once.
So last round of questions.
And the last question. I would like to ask both actually Uri and Ilan. How do you translate? How does Israel translate? KKL, I think it is Karen Kayemet Israel.
Correct.
Okay. To JNF, what's the relation in translation, I mean? That perplexes me. Okay. It doesn't relate in any translational form. Israel is not Jewish. current probably is fun, probably. And Kayemet, how is it measured? I mean, how do you translate that? Thank you.
Yeah.
I have a question from one audience in the room to Dr. Davis. Dr. Davis talks about covert apartheid, but what about the nation-state law that enshrines Jewish privilege in law? And also, the current government is taking steps to further enshrine Jewish privilege in law. So that's the second question, and here's the third one.
Thank you so much. My name is Sonia Najjar, and I was wondering if you could comment on, if you could comment on the difference between petty apartheid and blatant, very visual apartheid, such as the wall, the violence in East Jerusalem, the occupation of the West Bank, siege of Gaza, and people's willingness, the international community's willingness, actually, not to take action in terms of the implementation of international law, or their willingness also just not to see people on a daily basis. Thank you.
Which question do you want to start?
I mean, bits and pieces of the last question. I'll try and address briefly the questions in reverse order. The siege of Gaza is not petty apartheid. I referred to toilets for whites and toilets for non-whites, Jews for the toilet for Jews and toilets for non-Jews, lines in the airport for blacks and not blacks, white and not whites, and that level, transport, separate transport for bus, in buses, public areas between Jews and non-Jews, in-law, whites and not whites, in-law, that area I refer to as petty apartheid. The siege of Gaza is a war crime and a crime against humanity, it's not petty apartheid. And of course it is perpetrated in law. So again, I can only re-emphasize the difference between popular racism and apartheid. To my reading is that apartheid is regulating racism in law. Now we have the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which in my view is a critically significant document produced by the United Nations Organization. It sets the normative standards of adjudicating or judging or evaluating to what degree a member state in the United Nations approaches these values or distances its values. And apartheid is regarded to almost the worst distance that a state can take from the values of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So when Israeli ambassadors keep complaining, why do you single out the state of Israel? There are a good many reasons for singling out the state of Israel, for BDS, boycott, divestment and sanctions. One is that Israeli apartheid is not a past criminality, it's an ongoing criminality. Israel ethnic cleansing is not a past criminality, but it's an ongoing criminality. And the second is that, to my knowledge, I regret that I did not have the opportunity to do a proper academic research in that particular field. But to my knowledge, and I'd be happy to be corrected, Israel is the only state in the United Nations organization that reserves just over 90% of its territory for Jews only, or for a section of its population only. And I'm waiting for somebody to tell me, look, there's this particular state that has the same land tenure, it reserves just over 90% of its territory to Slavs only, or to Protestants only, etc., etc., etc. And then I would simply say, well, it's no big deal. There is the 1973 International Covenant on the Suppression and Punishment of the Crime of Apartheid. Applied on the rogue state of Israel. And if there is another state that preserves just over 90% of its territory to one section of the population, applied to this other state. And if there are three such states, it applied to all three states. But as far as I know, until now, only one state does that kind of apartheid distance itself so extremely from the values of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. You don't want to be singled out, dismantle your apartheid regime.
Thank you.
The other question about the Israel nationality law. Again, I won't go into the internal contradictions, but I'll put my neck on the chopping block. There is a difference between the humanitarian narrative and the political narrative. In terms of humanitarian narrative, the current government of the State of Israel is a disaster, a tragedy, a criminality, and whatever word you would do against the Palestinian people. In political terms, it's the best government for the Palestinian people. They simply expose their own criminality. And that was the first question, remind me please.
About the, so there was...
The translation of the word.
Yeah. Israel, you should know, Israel is not just the name of a state. Israel is an equivalent, a synonymous name to the Jewish people.
Really?
So as you have led Israel, it's not just for the state of Israel, it's for the Jewish people. And the state of Israel is called the state of Israel. It is, an ambiguity that only people who are familiar with the Hebrew language would recognize. It's also the state of the Jewish people. Mm-hmm. Keren is foundation. Kayemet is indefinite. So the property of the Jewish National Fund is the property in the indefinite possession of the Jewish people.
And I correct that one. And I correct that. When they did the first initial meeting and decided about the name, Keren Hakayemet.
Jewish National Fund.
No, wait a minute.
Ah, you mean the Congress.
Uri, let me try. Sorry, I want to say I'm very happy.
Sorry.
Okay. This is an important thing because it has to do with the way Zionism, and especially people like Ben-Gurion, manipulated Jewish theology and sacred texts in order to hint, especially to the Christian world and the Jewish world, that actually already in the Bible and in Jewish thinking, there was already an indication that Zionism is a valid. Why do I say it? Because they chose the name from something which is called Hamishnah. Hamishnah is part of the Talmudic Jewish learning. And in the Mishnah, it says, I'll say it in Hebrew, okay? And then I'll translate, which would be a terrible translation, but never mind. They took the sentence, Ochel porotehen ba'olam hazeh, hakeren hakayemet lo la'olam haba. The one who eats the fruits in this world would have the benefit of it also in the next world. Why did they choose this particular phrase from the Mishnah? They wanted to say, remember, they had a problem when they were founded that most of the Jews in the world thought that Judaism was religion, not an ideology. So they wanted to convince them that any donations that they would give to the colonial project in Palestine would be remembered when they come, when they die and come to heaven, to the next world, or whatever you call the next world. Definitely Uri and I am going. I don't know about you. So that was the idea of the Keren Hakayemet. It's taken directly. It's a direct quote from the Mishnah, and of course later on you're right. That was the idea. Was supposed to expand it, but originally, and I have, I'm working on a book on this, so I'm quite familiar with it now. There were many incredible things which they did with this huge Jewish theological background, and they Zionized it. The Zionist text, which meant to regulate the relationship between a person and a person, the faithful and the faithful, man and God, and they tried to convince people by detextualizing it, by decontextualizing this, that actually already in the Mishnah, in the Talmud, and of course in the Old Testament, there were already the signs that Zionism is God's will. Now what is, of course, incredible about these people, that they were secular Jews. These were people who did not believe in God, but they believed that God promised them Palestine.
Would you allow me, you know?
Yeah.
My concise definition of Zionism is rather concise.
Well, you are not a concise person.
Well, this is an exception.
Okay.
Zionism is the politicization of the Jewish religion, just as Daesh is the politicization of Muslim religion.
With this very rich, yeah, we have to.
I want to add an example useful for this book. That one named his family named Matlub, Israeli one, was living in Lifta when Israeli Land Department made the plan to build to change Lifta for
luxury villas and a colony, which made
by Sharon, I mean, he was the infrastructure minister. He refused to leave the house that Israeli Land Department gave him to live in 1951. The house is Liftawi house. He refused to leave till he has compensation. They gave him, he said, 7 million shekels. One day we found him that he seized a house, occupied a house, Liftawi house, contained 6 rooms, 2 floors, and changed it for a hotel, and he left a boutique. Our Liftawi's lawyer went to the municipality and asked if it is licensed or not. They said, no, it is not licensed. Okay, it is not licensed. Why you buried him, or you are silent, or you do not see him? He said, yani he said that he bought the house from Jerusalem Fund. Yani the minister financing gave him the money, and he bought the house from Jerusalem Fund, and still he is going on. Yani how they play the game, yani the Israeli Land Department or the finance, the pressure or the also municipality. So now he is, yani, if you ask him a room, he said, no, it's 3 months I can give you. After, yes, you can. And I think the best hotel in Israel do not ask a price like him. Lift a boutique. So I ask, this is my message to you, that he occupied our house and she for a hotel. So don't go.
Thank you very much. I'm not going to be too long. I'm just going to thank Inès for taking care of moderation today. And just give me 2 minutes before you leave, because this is quite important. I've just been approached by a young Palestinian girl who was inspired tonight and wrote a piece of poetry. And if you're in a panel like this and you work in a bookshop and some young girl come to you and say, I was inspired and I wrote a piece of poetry and I want to read it, You can't really say no. So I'm going to ask Tala to read for us what she just wrote.
Good evening, everybody. So it's just joining a few notes as we listen to Mr. Professor Ilan Pappe and Dr. Uri Davis, and I was just joining some random stuff, and then suddenly I was looking at the piece, I was like, ah, art! So without further ado, I present to you this piece of art. The venue has been changed. Reasons remain inconclusive. The book launch happened, as life often demonstrates, success is elusive. But Jerusalemite academic and civil rights activist Uri Davis's birthday was celebrated June 8th, 8 decades of life. Persistence, endurance, subsisted. To break the ice, in a form of an apology, Honorable Davis announced, "My mustache overlaps my lower lip by means to avoid fear among the audience by cause of a previous visit to the dentist." To which Professor Ilan Pappe declared, "To your credit, even before your previous visit to the dentist, many feared your mere presence." Joking, coping, reality. Comfort leaves this art as we discuss cacao, greenwashing, petty apartheid, morality, and the legality of a vicious reality. I came to this event to run away from my studies, exam season of a senior law student, that is. In my studies and at this event, jargons overlap, but interpretations differ. I am a mishpatanit, urechid din atid, confusion, self-constructive criticism. This is my conclusion.
Thank you. Thank you, Tala. When we thought about putting this event together, we also thought about what is the best way to kind of encounter JNF work a little bit. And then we talked to the team at the bookshop, and we thought of an idea that I hope it will really come to your taste. We actually went to the mountains around Jerusalem at the end of the season of the za'atar. We picked up a few za'atar and we gave them to our team, and we made za'atar cookies from the land of Palestine, west of Jerusalem. On your way out, don't miss to taste them. They'll be cooked today at the bookshop. Now to some celebration as the cake comes in. This is the book, it's on sale outside. Of course, I have to do the sales pitch. And if I can ask you to close this event by standing up and singing happy birthday to me. Thank you.